In the last lecture, we explored how vectors add. Now, we know that we live in the so called three-dimensional space, although we have not said what we mean by that. We will explore that later. And the model for that is R3. So, everything mechanics is discussed, the space in which the mechanics is discussed is in R3. So, let us look at the structure of R3 and what kind of objects that you encounter inside R3, that is one thing. But it is often difficult to draw the pictures for R3, therefore, we begin with R2. R1, which is the same as R, is something that we are already familiar with, and I will just dispose it of in 1 or 2 minutes. So, let us look at R1. R1 is essentially the same as the real line. What do we have on real line? You have a 0, you have a unit length. Once we fix the 0 and the unit length, then every point has a real number corresponding to it. So, an arbitrary point can be x is the address of that particular point. Now, you know that if you take two numbers, add, you get a third number. You can multiply numbers and also get another number. And there are certain rules that follow along with it, which you are all familiar with. So, I do not want to recall that. But it is somewhat less descriptive or lacks insight. So, we often go to describe R2 and R3, which will give the features of these spaces. So, let us start with R2. What is R2? R2 is essentially R cross R, and mathematically it is the set of all ordered pairs x1, x2 such that xi belongs to R. It is this set of ordered pair of numbers that you have. Now, on R2, now we have earlier said that in R2, every point can be realized as a vector, and we have vector addition. We adopt the vector addition as the rule for addition in R2. Therefore, suppose you have x corresponds to x1, x2 and y corresponds to y1, y2. Then we define x plus y defined as, this stands for defined, two dots and a. So, this is a definition. Y2. Also, we often encounter one more type of action, namely take a vector, multiply by a scalar, then you get another vector. What is that vector? That vector is actually k times x is defined as this is another ordered pair that you get. Multiply each of the component by k. This is what you mean by kx, where k belongs to R and x1 belongs to R2. We will look at the meaning of this. Okay? In fact, one can actually prove using, like we did with the vector addition, if you add up to, if you multiply a vector by a scalar, then what you produce is another vector along the same line generated by the vector, and the coordinates are given by k times each of the components of the vector. This can be easily proved. Now, I will draw the picture. So, what you have is this. This is a model of R2. This is O. Then you have a vector x. So, this point is x1, x2. Now, suppose I multiply by a scalar, some fixed number. What I get is that if this number is positive and greater than 1, then I am elongating the vector. If it is equal to 1, then I get the same vector. If it lies between 0 and 1, then I contract the vector. And if I use a negative number, then what I do is I reverse the direction of the vector, but along the same line, and this is what happens. So, you have got all the different cases. So, what you have is that by choosing different real numbers, you can actually get a new line generated along the direction of the given vector. So, every point on this line can be obtained as a scalar multiple of the vector x1, x2. This is what you have. So, you have, what you have is this line and any point on this is of the form, say suppose this is some y1, y2, then you can actually prove that using, if this length is k times this, suppose the length of this is k times this, that is O P O Q. Suppose or I will put it this way, O Q is equal to k times O P. This is something that can be easily proved, because you have two similar triangles OPM and OQN, and then you see that OM by ON, I am talking about length, is equal to the length OP divided by length OQ, and OM is x1, ON is equal to y1, therefore, you can easily compute the relationship, and this is what it turns out. Therefore, you have another operation, that is generating a new vector from a given vector is by multiplying it by a real number, okay? It is a new way of, by adding two vectors, you can generate a third vector. By scalar multiplying a vector, you can get a new vector. If you combine these two operations with all the possibilities, then you keep getting all sorts of vectors. Now, we are going to explore what you finally. So, these are the rules of addition and scalar multiplication. Now, one observes that there is a vector called zero vector. What is the zero vector? The zero vector corresponds to the origin. I mean, no direction can be attributed to this vector. It is a hypothetical limiting situation that you have. And the zero vector has the, so if you want you can put a sort of thing here to see that this is vector and these zeros are scalars. So, what you have is that, say in fact, it immediately follows that this addition that you have is commutative. That means, you can show that x plus y equal to y plus x. The addition is associative in the sense that x plus that means you are having a third vector namely z possibly with the coordinates z1 and z2. Then the meaning of these brackets has to be understood properly. It is x plus y plus z. So, you first add y plus z and then add it to x. Here what you are saying is you add first x with y and then add that sum to z. What this relation or this statement says is that x plus y plus z is the same as x plus y plus z. So, this is to be properly understood. This is called associativity. This is easily proved because of the associativity of addition of numbers. I am not going into the details, you do it. Then you have x plus y equal to y plus x. This is what is called commutativity. So, the addition is commutative, addition is associative, then there exists a vector zero such that x, all these checks very well with your parallelogram law, all come from that. Okay. A further property that you, so this is 1, 2, 3. Now you see that for each vector, for every belonging to R2, there exists minus x such that this is what is called the additive inverse. Okay. The zero vector is called the additive identity element, and these four properties are there. And if you have any system in which there is a binary operation plus satisfying these four properties, then you say it is a commutative group. So, R2 is a commutative group. Okay. Now, what is the other operation that we have? It is scalar multiplication. So, we have to see how this scalar multiplication in fact interacts with the binary operation addition. So, we look at those properties. Now, what you have is k times x plus y can be shown to be k x plus k y. Okay. See here, k is picked from R. On R, there are two operations. What are the operations? There is an addition, there is a multiplication. So we have to say how your vector addition is going to interact with those two operations. So what we say is the following. So let us explore. K1 plus K2 of x, you can show that this is equal to K1 x plus K2 x. This you can prove, it's not difficult. Then you have K1 K2 x is essentially K1 right. Then you have what is called a multiplicative identity in R, that is denoted by 1. So what you can prove is what you have is that 1 into x is equal to x, where 1 is the multiplicative identity in R. And from this one can prove this also, that is 0 into x is essentially equal to 0 where 0 belongs to the 0 element of. So, all these properties one can prove. Okay. So, these are the sort of properties of R2 that you have. There is a addition rule which is a binary operation. There is a scalar multiplication, and we have also described how these two operations do interact. Now, this is a distributive property, this is also a distributive property. Okay? All these properties we have explained. Okay. So, having seen this, now we want to explore the geometry of R2, then after that we go to R3. So, we will take up this. Suppose V belongs to R2 and V is not equal to the 0 vector. So, V can be written as V1 with coordinates V1, V2. So, it is a non-zero vector. Let me draw this for the sake of making it different. This is the given vector in this direction. Okay. Now, we look at the x equal to the scalar multiple of this. So, the scalar multiple, when you run over the entire set of scalars, generates a line. Okay. Now, what is the equation of this line? The equation of this line is obtained if you can describe an arbitrary point on this line. An arbitrary point on this line is going to be x given by t times v, where t belongs to. So, this describes the whole line. Every point on this line can be obtained this. Now, what does this mean? This means there are two equations. The equations are, if you take the components on this and components on this. Okay. You might ask, what do you mean by two vectors are equal? Say that a vector x is equal to a vector y when each component is equal to the corresponding component of the other. So, x equal to y if and only if x1 equal to y1, x2 equal to y2. So, recall that x is equal to y if and only if x1 Therefore, what does this mean? This means x1, x2 is equal to t times v1, v2, which is equal to t v2. So, that gives two equations. What are the equations? The equations are x1 equal to t v1, x2 equal to t v2. These are two equations now. Okay? That is a parametric representation of a straight line through the origin. Okay? It passes through the origin. For instance, if you take the value t equal to 0, then you produce the origin. Okay? That is the reason why it passes through the origin. So, this is a line, this is the of the line generated by the vector, which is not equal to 0. If v is equal to 0, what would happen? V is equal to 0, then t v is going to be always equal to 0, which means you do not get a line. Or if you are very particular, you can say that what you get is a degenerate line which reduces to a point. That is the origin. Okay? So, we take v not equal to 0, so that you get a non-trivial line. Got it. Now, what we do? Okay. So, but we know that in analytical geometry, we already had the equation of a line, looked at. And what was the equation of a line passing through the origin? It was of the form a1 x1 plus a2 x2 equal to 0. Okay? So, from your analytical geometry, the equation of the line, equation of passing through the origin is zero. How these two are the same? Because after all, they have to be the same. You are saying that this is the equation of a line passing through the origin. By choosing different v, you can generate different lines. In fact, all the lines passing through the origin can be generated. See? By choosing different vectors. But how do we get this form from this? This is the first question. Okay? So, this is the vector form of the equation of the line. This is the scalar form of the line. Are they the same? If they are the same, we should be able to derive one from the other. How do we do that? So, you have two equations here. X1 is equal to t v1, x2 equal to t v2, where t is the parameter. And if you eliminate the parameter t between these two equations, okay, you get a relation connecting x1, x2, v1, v2. What is that? Multiply this by v2 and this by v1 and subtract. Okay? So, you get these two relations implies or you can rewrite it as V2x1 minus V1x2 equal to 0, and compare with 2, then what you have is V2 equal to A1 minus V1 is equal to A2. Okay. Therefore, 1 implies 3, or 1 implies 3, which is like the standard form of the equation passing through the origin. Okay. What about these, the converse true? Let us explore it. So, to explore this, what do you have to take? Again, go back to your R2. Suppose you are having a line passing through the origin. You have a line passing through the origin and whose equation is given by zero. Okay, know how to draw the line, the graph of the line. Of course, there is one condition that you have to use here. The condition is that a1 square plus a2 square not equal to 0. What does it mean? It means that both a1 and a2 cannot be simultaneously 0. At least one of them is different from 0. So, this condition is there. So, we have a1 x1 plus a2 x2 equal to 0. Otherwise, what happens is this will be simply 0 equal to 0. So, it will tell you nothing. So, we assume this. Now, the geometry tells you something from our experience here. How did we generate this line? We have chosen a vector in this direction, a non-zero vector, and scalar multiplied it. Okay. So, what you do is choose some vector on this line. Okay. What do you mean by that? It means choose a point other than 0 that lies on this. Okay. Then that will give you a non-zero vector. I mean, there is no restriction on which vector you should choose, except that that vector cannot be the 0 vector. Okay. So, anything other than the 0 vector that lies on this line would help you. So, let me call this V. So, this is V1, V2. So, choose zero. This is the choice that you have to make. Once you make this choice, then you see that the line that you write x equal to t v will give you the same line. I mean, that is the geometry, but we have to explore this whether it is true or not. Okay. So, we have chosen V1, V2 as a point on the given line. Okay. So, we choose V as V1, V2, which lies on this line, and we know that this line is then generated by the vector V. This is what is clear from the geometry. But is it analytically true? So, we have to prove this. Okay? So, we do some computation. So, how did we choose this V1, V2? We have chosen this V1, V2 as a point lying on this line. Okay? So, can you get a suitable point on this line? Let us see. So, the it means that you should have the V1, V2 should be such that A1 V1 plus A2 V2 equal to 0. Okay? So, we choose and a simple choice of such a point is given by V1 equal to minus A2 and V2 equal to A1. Okay? That is one choice. In fact, any scalar multiple of that is an equally good choice. Okay? So, we make the simple choice and start computing it. Therefore, what do you get? Therefore, you have x is equal to, that is x1, x2 equal to t times minus a2 a1. That gives you two equations. Now, eliminate t between these two and verify that you end up with a1 x1 plus a2 x2 equal to 0. Okay? So, that is the proof either way. So, this is how you generate this. Now, before I proceed any further, I will write a problem. Okay, right. That is a problem, a simple problem to work out. Now, here you see that since we have already chosen a1 square plus a2 square not equal to 0, you are assured that the vector minus a2 a1 is in fact not equal to 0. So, you see that any line passing through the origin can be rewritten in the vector form. Now, we ask a general question. Suppose you have a line not necessarily passing through the origin. Can you express this in a vector form? Okay. So, the general form of a where a1 a2 where a1 square plus a2 square not equal to 0 these are our real numbers and b is also some number belonging to R. So, when b equal to 0 you are in that case. So, b equal to 0 the case we have already explored. So, let us again draw some pictures because it always gives you a lot of insight into it. How do we resolve this problem? Now, this is the crucial thing. Now, this is again a copy of R2. What you have is some line not necessarily passing through the origin. So, assume this is of the form a1 x1 plus B, where B is not equal to 0 in that case. If it passes through the origin, then B equal to 0. Now, how do we solve this problem? So, there is that famous statement by Polya. If you have a problem which you do not know how to solve, you really look at another problem or see whether the given problem can be transformed into another one which you are already familiar with. Okay? What is the problem that we have already solved? We have solved the problem with the line passing through the origin. So, can you convert that into that problem? Let us see. First of all, you observe that there is a unique line passing through the origin parallel to this line. Okay? That is because that is from classical geometry that you have given a line and a point not on that line, there exists a unique line in the plane which is parallel to it and passing through that given point. So, we will draw that line. The line is parallel to the given line. So, this is the new line that emerges. And we also know the equation of this line. What is the equation of this line? From your classical analytical geometry, you know that the equation of this line is a1x1 plus. So, we know how to express this in the vector form. There is no problem. Once you get this in the vector form, then the question is how to get this from this. Okay, using some vector manipulation. This is the problem that you have. One thing that you observe is that since these two lines are parallel to one another, you can actually translate the line passing through the origin parallelly to the other line. Okay? So, what you do is, how to translate it? I mean, there are several ways in which you can do this. What you do is, you fix the point 0 and make it travel along some direction, along a line. Don't change its direction. You choose some direction in which you make this 0 travel. Okay? So, you translated it parallelly such that the 0 is moves along a line and until this line coincides with the given line. Now, this is a vector. So, denote this vector by some C. Okay? So, let us now explore. So, you assume that we have already got some V and this is of the form x is equal to TV, right? So, you are taking an arbitrary point on this. So, if you take this point, then this is some T1V. Now, add C to it, what do you get? How do you add it? Using the parallelogram law, there is no other way in which vectors can be added. Okay? Complete the parallelogram. And this is your TV, T1V, and T1V plus C equal to this particular point. So, this is C plus T1V. Okay? Now, vary T1 over R, generate all the points on the line. So, you see that there is a way in which you can redraw that line starting from this. Okay? So, this is the whole idea. So, what have we done? We explored whether there is a problem that we are already familiar with, converted into a vector form. We observed that there is a line passing through the origin parallel to the given line which can be expressed in the vector form. Now, the given line can be obtained as a translate of this. So, we use this idea. So, we get this line turns out to be what? X is equal to TV plus C. So, that is the equation of the line. Okay? So, the problem is simple. Given the line, draw the line parallel to it through the origin. Okay? Express it in the vector form. And then you have translated it back. Translate it back, moving the origin along a vector, okay, until you reach this line, so that you would regain the given line. So, this is what you get. So, you see that this is equal to, so choose V not equal to 0 along equal to 0, then this line is given by x equal to TV. In the vector form. Now, translate this. Now, choose a point denoted by the vector C on the line, on the given line. Now, translate. The line x is equal to TV along C parallelly. This means 0 moves along vector C, keeping the translation parallel until it the given line. That's it. Okay? Then the equation of the new line is this may be this is as we have seen using parallelogram law. I have described it earlier. So, we have successfully obtained an arbitrary line in the vector form. Okay? Right? So, it has been done in two different steps. Now, these are all important to understand, because this is how mathematical problems are solved. If you can't prove a general problem, solve a general problem, what you try to do is try to solve a special case of that. Then you will get some insight into it. Once you get the insight into it, use that information to solve the original problem, if it is possible. Sometimes it is possible, sometimes it will be difficult, and this is what happens. So, general thing. So, here we looked at the how we work on lines through the origin, that is a restricted class of lines. You resolve the problem there, and then of course, we explore the more general case, and we used it very, very profitably, the information about the lines passing through the origin in resolving the other problem. Now, this is the important thing. Okay. Let us convince ourselves that what we have done is gives you this. So, what do you have? You have x equal to, so you have two scalar equations, namely x1 equal to c2. Okay. So, what you end up is that you have x1 minus c1 equal to t v1, x2 minus c2 equal to t v2, or you have v2 into x1 minus c1 equal to v1 into c2. And this is again, if you write, this is v2 x1 minus v1 x2 equal to some constant. So, it is some line that you have. Now, you see that you also use the fact that a1 c1 plus a2 c2 equal to b. So, use, then verify that we have this is the same as this, because we already know v2 and v1 are, see v2 you are choosing probably minus a2 and v1 as minus a2 and v2 as a1, and then you substitute and use the fact that c1 c2 are such that it lies satisfies this condition, therefore you will finally get b. So, that is up to you to verify. In fact, it is better you do the computation. Okay. So, we have successfully transformed a scalar equation into a vector form, and the converse process is exactly as you did in the other case. In fact, I have done it on the way of proving this, because you get this equation. This is the scalar equation. Starting from this vector equation, you can get the scalar equation. Okay. But there are a few points that we would like to look at more carefully. First of all, you found that the choice of V is not unique. Okay? V can be anything other than the 0 vector lying on that line. So, the choice of V is not unique. Once again, the choice of C is also not unique. So, C can be some vector lying whose tip is lying on that given line. Okay? Therefore, there is non-uniqueness. In fact, there are plenty of choices that you can make. It is not completely arbitrary, but with some conditions. The condition is that V has to be any non-zero vector lying on the line passing through the origin. C has to be any point lying on the given line. Okay? So, this is what we observe. Therefore, there is a mathematical problem involved. We have seen that the given line can be described in several ways. How are these related? Because we already know that if these two representations are totally arbitrary, then they may represent different lines. But there is a relation between them. So that's the first question. In other words, put it mathematically, this is the question. Suppose we have two different representations of the line B, okay. How are they? As x equal to t c and x equal to t d. These are two representations. It is possible. All that I do is, instead of V, I choose U, which is again lying on that line. Instead of C, I choose D, which is again lying on the given line. Okay. So, we have to essentially prove that these two are the same, they are identical. So, mathematically, let me put it this way, this is a little bit about the mathematical language also. Suppose I define L V C, I define as the set of all x such that x is equal to, you know that this is in, this is a subset of R2, okay. So, I also have another one U D, this is defined as x such that x is equal to So, mathematically they are two subsets of R2, they are two subsets of R2. So, you want to show that these two subsets are identical, okay. What does it mean by that? LVC is contained in LUD and LUD is contained in LVC. So, you have to prove these two, okay. But first of all, what is the, what relation, we have to put it in a form, what is the relation between U and V and C and D which serves this purpose? Our geometric explorations show that V has to be some k times U, where k is not equal to 0, U and V are not equal to 0, because this has to be non-zero, okay. And C and D should lie on the same line. So, this is the scenario. Suppose this is C, this is C, D, then this vector and this vector are, okay. So, what do you have? When does this become a triangle? You would have seen in your physics that this can be expressed either as C minus D or D minus C, and you know there is the addition, but strictly that's a shortcut. But the actual thing is that you look at C minus D. What is C minus D? Take C What is minus d? Minus d is a vector in the opposite direction. So this is minus d. This is minus d. Okay. Now c plus minus d is what? Complete the parallelogram. There is no other go. This complete the parallelogram. Then you see that c minus d is actually lying on this line. Okay. This is your or this. Okay, and C and D belongs to this is x is equal to no T V plus so what do you need? You see that if you complete the parallelogram, it is quite easy to prove that this lies along this line geometrically. That means C minus D should belong to this line. Therefore, C minus sum R into for sum R. Now you see that this becomes 0, then C equal to D, and that is not ruled out. Okay. So we resolved the problem at least outwardly. So what is going to be your theorem? Your theorem is going to be the following. LVC is equal to L if and only if there exists k not equal to 0 such that u is equal to k times v and there exists r belonging to r such that c minus d is equal to r times. That is the theorem. That is the statement of the theorem. It is a powerful theorem. It says two things. LVC is equal to LUD if and only if this condition is satisfied. So, you have to do two things. First, assume LVC equal to LUD. Now, show that there exists a k. So, you have to actually get the k and get the r such that this is true. Okay. Conversely, assume that there exists a k and r as prescribed there, then you show that the set LVC equal to LUD. There again, if you want to show two sets are equal, you have to show one is contained in the other and the other is contained in this. I mean, this is relatively simple because if you prove one of them, you can just reverse the whole argument with V replaced by U and C replaced by D. So, it is enough to prove LVC is contained in LUD or LUD is contained in LVC. You can reverse the argument and get this. Okay. So, I think I should leave it as a problem. It is a very important result. Now, you see how from such elementary situations, very good mathematics comes, and it is a very demanding thing. You need little bit of professionalism to write down the proof perfectly. It is a good exercise. So, show this proof. So, I can continue with R3 now. Okay. Any questions?
Sir, you said that there are several representations of the same line, which means the representation is not unique. What interpretation can you give to this non-uniqueness of representation?
Yes, that is a very interesting question. question, because it needs some dynamic explanation. Now you see that the line that we have drawn there, that is x is equal to tv plus c, which is represented by a1x1 plus a2x2 equal to b, is a line. So you can compare this with a railway line, okay? And then you have the railway lines are intended for trains to run either way, okay? Right. And trains can run at different velocities also, not necessarily at the same speed, okay? So what you have here is the following. Let us look at this as an equation representing the trajectory of a particle moving. See, the situation is very fascinating. We try to give a dynamical representation for the whole problem. So you have a path. There is a reference system. And then you see xt, this is the vector xt can be written as something like this, a. Suppose that is the path. This talks about the position of the particle along a certain trajectory. We are assuming that v is a constant velocity with which the particle is moving. In that case, this would be the equation of motion. Now, what is your a and v? You can see that the rate of change of position gives you the velocity. So dx by dt is v. So this is the velocity. Now x at 0 is essentially equal to a. Therefore, the equation represents x equal to tv plus a represents the path traced by a particle moving with velocity v starting at a at t equal to 0. Okay? See, the same path may be traced by something which starts off at some other b and moving the velocity u. That's why I said the analogy of the train, railway line, and the trains running on it. Because the railway line is something static, and the railway line is represented by that equation a1x1 plus a2x2 equal to some constant. Okay? It does not change at all. Whereas the trains running on them runs in all sorts of directions. If v is given, minus v corresponds to something that runs in the opposite direction. Okay? And at t equal to 0, you are at the point A. Therefore, this takes care of all possible dynamical systems where there are particles moving with different constant velocities and starting at different points. That's the interpretation. Okay? So you see, you get all these interpretations coming out well. Yeah. Sir, any other question?
Sir, is it possible to extend these concepts to higher dimensions?
Yeah. It is possible, in fact. We will explore this, and there are more possibilities coming out there, and we will explore that in the next part, namely when we consider R3, because that itself is very interesting. Right. Thank you very much.